a divine welcome to our service this morning. I'd like to say, Lord, from the start, thank you for breaking through my heart. Thank you for tearing every chain apart. When I was lost, you made a way. You turned the darkest night.
To the King, amen, and lift up the name of Jesus. Welcome this first Sunday of August. It's hard to believe, but time is marching quickly along, and we are so glad that you are here. Welcome to those who are watching on Facebook or YouTube or our website as well this morning. We don't want to leave you all out. We wish you could be here, but we understand, and we're glad you're here. Welcome, church family, and it's good to be in the house of the Lord, amen. Amen. Looking forward to worshiping with you and sharing some news. We have gone back to printing a smaller version of our bulletin, but these are at the Welcome Center. We're not handing them out. You have to get one for yourself up there for safety's sake, but we want you to get those if you'd like them. And let me just get started before we pray this morning with explanation. We are we certainly understand all that's going on with the COVID and the masks and all of that, and we are not anti-mask, and you are more than welcome to wear a mask. We have plenty of them out at the Welcome Center, but there's a lot of confusion as to what is mandated here and there. And so just a quick review, July 1st, the mayor ordered that a mandate and said that churches are exempt in the city. And then on July 8th, Governor Kemp overruled his mandate. And then on July 31st, the county commission ordered that churches were included but were to self-regulate, which still means it's up to the individual to make their own decision. And then the governor came out a few hours later and overruled that one. And so my bottom line is they don't even know what they're doing together yet, collectively. And we've got three ordinances all in conflict with one another. And so according to WSAV, mask or face coverings could pose a problem for the local mandate due to the governor's restrictions. And so the governor has said it's not mandatory. So we're not against safety. We're not against masks. But until we get some more clarification, and I'll close with this, a spokesperson for the county said clarification would be sought in coming days, including it may be moot with the governor's order in place. So, bottom line, wear a mask if you want to, amen? And be cautious and be respectful of others. And if people choose not to, that's their business. If people choose to, that's their business. But we're here to worship the Lord, amen? Not to police masks. And so, anyway, we'll talk more about that. When we get clarification, when they get clarification, and it's all clarified. That makes sense? With that kind of speech, I could run for president, couldn't I? You know, that much double talk. Well, let's get started with prayer. We've got a lot of folks to pray for and a lot of people to congratulate. This must have been a great week to hear wedding bells, because we want to congratulate Bob and Fran Hager on August 4th, 64 years. Hold the phone. Craig and Glenda Johnson on the same day, 47 years. Herman and Diane Lee on the same day, 50 years. And then on August 6th, Jim and Gwen Coons, 49 years. And on August 6th, also Tommy and Vicki East, 43 years. And so congratulations to all these families. It's a great, great week to get married, apparently. And so we congratulate you. We also have some staff anniversaries. We want to congratulate Rachel Heath, celebrating 9 years of service. Yesterday, Michael Finley here, 3 years of service yesterday. Dwight Evans will be 5 years of service tomorrow. And then Kathy Hodges, 3 years here at the church portion. Of course, she was at the school since Abraham Lincoln was president. She was there a long time. And so congratulations to all these staff members and the great job they do. Amen. Let's give them a hand for their anniversaries. Well, let's get started with prayer. I'm going to ask Brother Michael. Certainly do pray for our country. We're not making light of any of this. Our country's in a mess, and we certainly need prayer and discernment and wisdom for our leaders on every level of government. And, you know, the church really is the best friend the government can have. And so we want to work together and encourage those folks and pray for them and lift them up. I was at an emergency scene on Wilmington Island yesterday, not far from the Mosley's house, and a couple officers there said, "Oh, please thank your church. We got those gift cards." And we were so appreciative of that. So like I said, we want to support our folks and our leaders, and we want to pray for them. So pray for our country, amen, on all levels, not just the national level, but on all levels. Let's lift these folks up today. So Brother Michael, would you come and lead us in prayer before we sing some more?
Let's pray. Father God, we do come to you, and Lord, we thank you for this day and this opportunity that we have to come in your house and to give you worship and praise, and Lord, to thank you for the many blessings. But Lord, we do pray for our country and our governmental leaders from city all the way up to our president. And we pray that you'll continue to work through them and through this time of just craziness and confusion. And Lord, we pray that we can, through all this, continue to give you glory and honor. We pray that you'd be with our services today. And Lord, we thank you for the ones that have showed up this morning. We pray for the next service as well. And Lord, even tonight. And Lord, we just pray and thank you for the opportunity that, again, we can gather in your house freely. And we pray that you'll be with these in our church that are dealing with sickness or surgeries or recovery, that you'll be with them and just continue to be with our music today and just continue to use Brother Jody just to, again, us lift up your name. Lord, be with us now. And Lord, continue to be with our church, be with the services, be with the message tonight and this morning, and that you would just use it in a mighty way. Lord, we love you. We thank you. In your name we pray. Amen. You may.
Thank you. You may be seated. One day there'll be no more masks to wear. Amen. One day there'll be no disease to be protected from. One day there'll be no death. One day there'll be a place where we can celebrate with the Savior that gave us new life. Amen. Let's sing together. One day when heaven was filled with his praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is he. The Word became flesh and the light shine among us, his glory revealed. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins. They nailed him to die on a tree, suffering anguish, despised and rejected, bearing our sins, my Redeemer is he. The hand that healed nations stretched out on a tree and took the nails for me. Living he loved me, and died save me, buried he carried my sins far away, and rising he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. Rose over death he had conquered, now is ascended, my Lord evermore. Death could not hold him, the grave could not keep him from rising again. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, and buried he carried my sins far away. Rising, he justified freely forever. And one day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. One day the trumpet will sound for his coming. One day skies with his glories will shine. One day they might be loved, one bringing my Savior Jesus is mine. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away, rising he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Reese. A beautiful song this morning. I want to invite Pastor Dwight Evans to come to the platform now. Pastor Dwight, we've restarted something the church used to do, and that is recognizing folks on their 5-year and 10-year anniversaries and such. And just tomorrow, Pastor Dwight Evans will celebrate 5 years as our children's pastor. And so congratulations to Brother Dwight. And we have a gift to you from the church of $500 as well as a certificate. As you know, Brother Dwight is transitioning to our senior care pastor here in a month or two, and so we're working on that transition. But as children's pastor says, certificate of appreciation presented to Dwight Evans, recognizing 5 years of service as our children's pastor, Bible Baptist Church, Savannah. And so we want you and Rhonda to have that. We want you to have this and Rhonda to have that. Okay? This and that. But God bless you and congratulations. Thank you, Brother Dwight. Thank you. And we have a good team of staff men and ladies, and we appreciate the work that they do. And they work hard. And just ask them, they'll tell you. Amen? They work hard. We've got a lot accomplished here in the last few years, and it couldn't have done it without a good team of people that were in place to help us get that done. So we are looking forward to these transitions coming together. Pastor Finley will be heading up our young couples, young married families, and we are searching for a youth pastor to take his place. And Brother Brad Hausman is taking over the children's department starting here in a few weeks. And so we got a lot going on, still moving things around, but I'm looking forward to it. When we can get back to full-time everything, I need you to think about something for me because you're the early service crowd. Again, I know why you're here. It's not that you just can't wait to come to church and hear the preacher. That's not why you're here. At the 8:30 service, you're here because you get out early. That's why you're here. I know that. You don't have to impress me. I get it. Amen, Kaiser? Kaiser wouldn't come to church for months until we had the early service. Then he started coming again. I don't know what's up with that. I said I wasn't going to pick on you, brother. I couldn't help it. It's just so easy. But anyway, here's what's going to happen. Lord willing, if we can keep marching forward slowly, steadily, safely with the reopening of our ministries, we got to get back to Sunday school. And we got to get back to our life group classes. And when we try to do that in September is the goal, this early service is going to have to shift to give us some time to get things, get Sunday school in the middle. Because it looks like we're going to have two services for a while to keep the crowd, you know, balanced, to spread out like this. So this early service in September is scheduled to go to 8 o'clock instead of 8:30. Okay, so you mark it down, start thinking about it, start planning. It's kind of like when kids go back to school, they have to go to bed early for a few nights to get ready. So you might want to start planning that already for 8 o'clock come September, Lord willing, unless this whole thing just vanishes away and we can get back to church like normal. Wouldn't that be wonderful? And we can pray. So just to be thinking that, wanted to put that plant in your mind, and we've got a few weeks of that before we make that change, but just so you can start thinking about it. And I'm telling you because you're the ones that come early. The 10:30 people don't matter to them. They ain't coming anyway. Amen? If they're not coming at 8:30, they're not coming at 8. I can tell you that. So it doesn't really matter what they think. It matters what y'all are good with. So 8 o'clock coming up in September. Well, in your Bibles, Mark chapter number 8. Mark chapter number 8. We certainly also want to pray for all those who are in the path of the tropical storm now. I'm thankful that it was downgraded, and it looks like it will have minimal impact in our area, but I know a lot of people are still going to get flooding and things along the coast, and it could strengthen again. In my pastor's page, I mentioned to you that a reliable source told me that when I was praying about coming to Savannah and conversing about that and discussing it with this reliable source, and the reliable source told me that hurricanes only come to Savannah about every 10 years and that one had just come through, I think Hurricane Michael or something, and so I didn't have anything to worry about for 10 years. And that reliable source was wrong, and I'm not going to name names, but it starts with Pastor and ends with Hubbard. Okay. So, a wonderful friend, a wonderful pastor, a wonderful teacher, he is. but a weatherman, he is not. All right? So if you have any reliable information from him, you might want to check that before you go forward with that. But would you stand with me, please, in honor of God's word, Mark chapter number 8. Mark chapter number 8 and verse 34. Speaking of our Lord Jesus, it says, "And when he had called the people unto him with his disciples also, he said unto them, Whosoever will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it, but whosoever shall lose his life for my sake and the gospel's, the same shall save it. For what shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? Whosoever therefore shall be ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him also shall the Son of Man be ashamed when he cometh in the glory of his Father with the holy angels." And all God's people said, amen. Thank you. You may be seated. I'm going to go back a few years with you in time because while we think about what we're currently facing and our attention has gone to politics and COVID and new restrictions, and I shared with the men at prayer breakfast yesterday, I tried to watch professional baseball on television Friday night. I tried. And I just couldn't do it. I just, you know, the fake noise. It's one thing when there's a laugh track on, on a show, but when you have a laugh track and a clapping track and an ooh and ah track on a baseball game, it's just not the same. And I don't even know what game I was watching, but they had cardboard cutouts of people behind home plate, and I said, "This looks like the Muppet Show." And the guy strikes out, and the crowd's all like, "Woo!" And there's no crowd. And then the guy gets a single, and again they go crazy. And you hear the dun 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 dun. I'm like, "This is fake." I mean, we've had fake news for a long time, but now we have fake sports. Don't get me started. But we are so in the moment right now, aren't we? We're so in the moment. I'm very concerned that we're so in the moment that we're not considering the future. We're not considering what this country is going to look like in 5 or 10 years if the leftists have their way. We're also so focused in the moment that we forget the past. We have forgotten the past. And I want to remind you, as recently as 5 years ago, ISIS beheaded 21 Christians on a beach in Jordan. And when they did that, I preached a message called "We Are People of the Cross." And the reason I chose that title is because they videotaped that and sent it out to news outlets around the world, the beheading of those 21 Christians, and they addressed their video to the people of the cross. And it was a warning sign. It was a statement. And this message today is not about Islam, and it's not about Muslim terrorists, although I could spend a lot of time on that. This message is about people of the cross. Who were they referring to? Why did they call us that? The people of the cross is one way that the Muslim faith identifies Christians. We're also referred to by them as people of the book. However, when they use that phrase, they're including Jews. Because as you know, the first 5 books of our Old Testament are the foundation of Judaism, the Torah, the books of Moses. And so they'll talk to Jews and Christians, and they will refer to them as people of the book. But when they refer to Christians only, it's the people of the cross, because the Jews don't accept that cross, but we do. Amen? For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved, it is the power of God. And so there was a very personal thing to me as a pastor when this video was sent out to the people of the cross. And I preached a series of messages about it at that time, and we did a study on Islam and all of that. And the first message that I preached explained who the people of the cross are. And if we don't know our history, friend, we can be led astray. If we don't know our history, we can be led astray. Christians have led the world in education, in science, in medicine, in technology, and in the arts. Christians have led the world in humanitarian aid and disaster relief around the world. And we used that phrase. We took it as a badge of honor for those, a little while after we got that video sent out to the world. Hey, we are the people of the cross. And we're not ashamed to be identified with the cross of Jesus Christ. We're not ashamed to be identified with the Savior who died on that cross. And so it was kind of a defiant statement. It was kind of a declaration that, yes, we're here. We are people of the cross. We know who you're talking to. We know why you're talking to us. But we just want you to know we're here. And the cross still has power to save. But as I was preaching that series and spent some time on that, we even had t-shirts made up. We are people of the cross. And we put that verse that I just quoted on there. Wore it all over the place. People of the cross. It was a great conversation starter. People say, what does that mean? Well, let me tell you about the cross of Jesus Christ. But listen, the people of the cross is not just a mere slogan. And it's not just a title of identity. To be a person of the cross needs to be a declaration to a lost world that needs a Savior. That I'm a person of the cross. I'm a person of Jesus Christ. I'm a person of the blood of the Lamb. And I can help you meet the Savior, Jesus Christ. I'm a person of the cross. I'm an agent, if you will. I'm an ambassador for Christ. Seems like I've read that phrase in our Bible. I am one of those people. If you're saved, say amen. Then you are by definition a person of the cross. And so it's more than just a statement, however. It has to be put into practice. So I took that series a step further and I said, what does it mean to be a person of the cross? What does it mean? You know, the media largely ignored all of that. Like they largely ignore a lot of good news, a lot of things. It almost seemed like they were sad that the hurricane was downgraded. I'm telling you, the reports I heard was almost like they're missing the joy of destruction and further catastrophe to the economy of the United States. Oh, it's only a tropical storm. Good night, nurse, with friends like that. Amen? When people are sad that we're not going to have a hurricane, that's pretty pathetic. When they're sad, when the economic numbers are in good shape, when they're sad, when people are getting back to work, when they're sad, when people are coming off unemployment, those should be good things. And so the media are largely overlooked that. But the people who sent that video knew exactly what they were talking about. And so on a deeper level, on a spiritual level, on a biblical level, there's something to this being a person of the cross. And if I'm going to name the name of Christ and I'm going to lift up the cross of Jesus, then I need to know what is expected of me as a person of the cross. What does it mean? And in our key verse there, number 34, it says, whosoever will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. Take up his cross and follow me. So let me give you just a couple quick things this morning about what it means to be a person of the cross. First of all, to live up to that name, to live up to that identity, we must be people who lift up the cross. To be a person of the cross, we need to be people who lift up the cross. Go to John chapter 3, please. John chapter 3. Jesus is about, he's in this conversation with Nicodemus. And we know verse 16 very, very well. We put it on all of those 500 gift cards that we prepared. We put John 3:16 on there. But look at verse 14. Jesus is speaking, and he said, and as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up. Verse 15, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have eternal life. And say this with me, please. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. That verse precedes Jesus saying he needed to be lifted up. And as Moses lifted up the serpent, and again, he's giving an example. And remember, in the wilderness, when they were bitten by those serpents, there was a brazen serpent put on a pole and raised up among the people, and they had to look and live. Look to the pole, look to the brazen serpent. And here we had to look to the cross to be healed, to be saved. And the cross is a powerful symbol, a powerful symbol. You would never know it from the NBA, but China is persecuting churches and Christians in record cases. And one way they're persecuting them is they are tearing down every cross. No church building is allowed to have a cross. Isn't that something? The symbol. They can't. It's not the preaching of the cross. It's the viewing of the cross they can't even handle. They don't even want to look at that cross. And where we're heading in this country is there'll be a day when they won't want that cross in this building. If they can tell you how to dress, they can tell you how to decorate. The mayor already has a homosexual task force that may not be too inclined to listen to my preaching. What happens when they don't like that? In the city of Savannah. Hey, we're people of the cross. We're going to lift the cross of Jesus. We're going to lift the name of Jesus. It's a powerful symbol. In those Muslim countries, when they were taking in those wars and they were coming into those Christian areas, demolishing the churches and tearing down all the crosses, they used crowbars, they used jackhammers, they used whatever they could to tear up all the crosses. They didn't want any image of the cross anywhere in those Muslim lands. The cross is a powerful symbol, and we must lift it up. Notice John chapter 12, verse 32. Again, John 12, 32, please. Jesus said it here, and if I be lifted up from the earth, will draw all men unto me. And to be a person of the cross, I need to demonstrate. I need to lift up the cross. Oh, I don't have to wear it around my neck. I don't have to wear it on my lapel. I need to lift up the person of the cross and the action that took place on the cross. I need to tell people about the cross of Jesus. We lift up the cross by telling the story of Jesus. We lift up the cross by telling of our Savior. Matthew 28, the Great Commission, you know it well. Verse 19. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. Verse 20, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Amen. We take the cross. Go and teach all nations. Go and teach the word of God. Go and lift up the cross. Tell what great things the Lord has done for you. Every time the gospel is shared, the cross is lifted up. Every time the Savior is elevated, as men realize the great price he paid for their redemption, the cross is lifted up. And as the people of Moses' day looked unto that pole, that brazen serpent for their healing, so today people need to look to the cross of Christ and be made whole again. As a person of the cross, are you lifting the cross? Are you lifting the Savior? Every time a soul is saved, the cross wins again. Every person who calls on the name of the Lord, the cross wins again. Remember in our old hymnal, it's not even in our most recent hymnal, I don't believe. It's in an old hymnal. It's called The Banner of the Cross. Ever heard that song? Marching on, marching on, for Christ count everything but loss, and we'll crown him king, toil and sing, neath the banner of the cross. We've got to lift high the cross of Jesus by telling the story, but also by our testimony. by our testimony. Don't be ashamed of the cross. That's what Jesus said in that verse about being ashamed of me and my words in this generation. He said, don't be ashamed. Notice 1 Corinthians 1:18. I think I quoted it a moment ago. 1 Corinthians 1:18. For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved, it is the power of God. Notice again Romans 1:16. Romans 1:16. For I am not what, church? Ashamed. I'm not ashamed. I'm a person of the cross. I'm here. I'm going to lift high the name of Jesus. I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. Too many Christians are hiding the cross. Too many Christians are ashamed of the Savior. I remember when President Obama was in his first term, there was a big controversy because he was speaking at a Catholic university and they had ordered all of the religious symbols and crosses to be covered with drapes before he spoke. I don't care who the speaker is, we're not covering the cross. Even for the President of the United States. Dr. Junior Hill, my friend, he preached here a couple years back. He's not in great health. He's not traveling near as much as he used to. But he shares in a message called Covering the Cross how he was watching the news one day and they were interviewing this church that was struggling financially, and they said they'd come to a partnership with a non-Christian group that wanted to use their building. And this, it was like an atheistic group or some kind of out there group. But they wanted to use their building, and so to make money, they allowed this group to use their building. And the reporter said, well, what do you do with the cross? And they said, oh, no problem. We just cover it up. We just cover it up. So for enough money, we'll just cover it up. Hello? You smelling what I'm cooking? It don't take money for some Christians to cover the cross. Just takes a little bit of embarrassment, a little bit of persecution, a little bit of disagreement, a little bit of wanting to fit in, and they'll cover the cross just like that. They'll be ashamed to be identified with the one who poured out his blood on that cross for their sins. We don't hide the cross with a drape, but many times the power of the cross is hidden in our lives by a poor testimony. Look at verse 38 again, please. Whosoever therefore shall be ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him also shall the Son of Man be ashamed when he cometh in the glory of his Father with the holy angels. The word has to do with disappointment. Disappointment. I remember hearing someone's testimony. They said the hardest thing, the most hurtful thing from their parents was not when their parents didn't yell at them. Their parents didn't cuss at them. You know you've been blessed if your parents don't yell at you and don't cuss at you. Amen. They said what hurt our heart. We'd rather my dad cussed at us than to say he was disappointed in us. Did you hear that? That hurt them more deeply for their parents to say, I'm disappointed in your actions. That cut them more deeply than if they'd have got cussed out. And make no mistake, Baptists know how to cuss. So Jesus said, I don't want to be disappointed. I won't be ashamed of you. And we may not hide the cross with a drape, but a lot of Christians are covering the cross today. Listen, friend, Christians involved in immorality are not lifting the cross of Jesus. Churches fussing and fighting and splitting are not lifting the cross of Jesus. Christians gossiping about one another are not lifting the cross of Jesus. Christians in adultery and addictions are not lifting the cross of Jesus. Christians drinking and gambling are not lifting the cross of Jesus. You might as well just put a blanket over it, because you're hiding the power of God in your life and you're rejecting the power of the cross by your testimony. If we're going to be people of the cross, we must lift up the cross. Secondly, if we're going to be people of the cross, we must live by the way of the cross. What does that mean? Go back, please, to Mark 8:34. And when he had called the people unto him with his disciples also, he said unto them, whosoever will come after me, here's the formula, let him deny himself and take up the cross and follow me. And so people of the cross, number two, live by the way of the cross. And that is the example of Christ himself. He is our greatest example in all things. Even Paul said to that church, be ye followers of me as I also am of Christ. Hey, don't follow the preacher, follow Christ. Don't follow the deacon, follow Christ. Don't follow the missionary, follow Christ. Christ gives us the example. First of all, it's 3 points. A denial of self. How do I live by the cross, the way of the cross? Denial of self. He said, let a man deny himself. You know how hard that is for us to do? To deny himself? I already let the staff have it this morning. I've been cutting back on Mountain Dew. Monday through Friday is a Mountain Dew free zone. I said that to Paul. It was 10:30 in the morning on Thursday. We were going somewhere. I said, man, I haven't had a Mountain Dew since Monday. He said, I had two this morning. True story. Michael Finley, can I get a witness? He was in the car with us. I've had two this morning. So Monday through Friday is a Mountain Dew free zone. But on the weekend, I let my hair down a little bit. And I'm out here yesterday, it was 95 degrees. And about noon, I'm push mowing. The new grass we put in, it's growing. We have to mow it like twice a week. So I'm push mowing over by the offices. Y'all ought to come over and see it sometime. It's beautiful. And if you'd like to mow it, you're welcome. And so I'm push mowing that thing. It's 95 degrees. I'm sweating off the pounds. And I thought, today's the day. Mountain Dew is calling my name. And so I go to Paul's classroom, where there's a huge refrigerator. Nothing. I crawl over to the auditorium, knowing that up in the home builder's room that I used to teach, there's a refrigerator that I kept fully stocked. I work my way up those steps, groaning every step. Make it to the refrigerator. Water. There's only water. I had to deny myself. I said, Parker's is down the street. Family Dollar's right there. But I'm going to deny myself and drink water. And I still haven't had a Mountain Dew to this very hour. But as soon as church is over, get out of my way. No, that's a silly example. But you know what? We're not very good at denying ourselves, are we? But that's the model of our Savior. Denying himself. Go with me to Luke chapter number 22. Luke 22, verse 39. Getting close to the cross now. And he came out and went as he was wont to the Mount of Olives. And his disciples also followed him, verse 40. And when he was at the place, he said unto them, pray ye that ye enter not into temptation. And he was withdrawn from them about a stone's cast and kneeled down and prayed, saying, Father, if thou be willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. To live by the way of the cross includes denying of self, not my will, not my will. Lord, I belong to you. I do not belong to myself. I've been bought with a price, and I'm not my own. And so, Lord, what you want me to do, what you tell me to do, where you tell me to go, not my will, but thy will be done. Where you want me to be. We had one of our veteran missionaries, his church has supported him since the days of Dr. Hodges, coming through town and called to see if he could use our mission department, and we set it up, and I'd not met him, Russ Daniels, to Uganda. He's on his way to Pennsylvania, and so my family took him out to dinner on Thursday evening. He's telling us about his 28 years in Uganda. And I'm thinking about, I thought Savannah was a big transition. They found spitting cobras in their kitchen. Hello. That's a transition. Why are you in Uganda? Half the population is under 15 years old. HIV and AIDS is everywhere. The average lifespan is less than 50 years old when he went over there for a Ugandan. 23% of the country has electricity. It's called denial of self. Denial of self. Think about that when you're complaining about your kitchen. At least there's no spitting cobras. At least you have electricity. At least some people are getting paid more to work to stay home than to work. That's not happening in Uganda. It's called denial of self. If any man come after me, let him deny himself. Not my will, Jesus said, but thine be done. And then it includes a submission to the Father. That's the second phrase, thine be done. It's not just that I'm going to deny myself, it's that I'm going to follow the will of God. So it's a two-part formula there. I'm going to deny myself so that I can follow the will of God. A submission to the Father. Not my will, but thine be done. And then it's a compassion for others. The way of the cross. When I say we must, if we're going to be people of the cross, we've got to live by the way of the cross. We've got to learn to deny ourselves. We've got to learn to follow the Father's will and submit ourselves to Him with the object of compassion for others. Think about this. Nothing about the cross was for Jesus' benefit. Nothing about the cross was for his own good. It was all about you. And it was all about me. People that live by the way of the cross have a compassion and a compulsion to love people, to do what they do for other people, to invest their lives and their time and their talent and their treasure for other people, not for themselves. A selflessness is the way of the cross. To represent Christ, to be ambassadors for Christ, we've got to know His formula. We're acting on His behalf. So you can't represent Christ and do your own thing. Well, that'll preach right there. If you don't like the current message, I can switch to that. You can't represent Christ and be your own person. Did you get that? We're going to get some new cameras here soon so I can come down. I have to stay here, stuck, imprisoned. You can't say, well, I'm my own person. Not if you're a person of the cross. I'm doing my own thing. Not if you're saved. Corinthians says, you are bought with a price and you are not your own. And so if I'm going to lift the cross and I'm going to live by the cross, then Jesus Christ is my example. Denial of self, submission to the Father, compassion for others. That's the formula. That's the record. A right understanding of who we are and who He is and what we are to be doing. As people of the cross, we need to demonstrate Christ-likeness in each of those areas I just mentioned. And then closing, people of the cross must look to the cross. We must look to the cross. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1. Wherefore, seeing we are also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us. Verse 2, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. What I'm trying to say to you, ladies and gentlemen, in this 21st century, in this chaotic and confused world, is that our focal point, and Paul talked about this Wednesday night, Paul Long, not Paul the Apostle, but Paul Long was quoting Paul the Apostle. Our focal point, our North Star, the center of our universe, needs to be the cross of Jesus Christ. The world wants to distract us. The world wants to destroy us. It's not just ISIS. It's the prince of this world and spiritual wickedness in high places that we wrestle against. And so the cross has to be our return point. The cross has to stay our focus, and we must not be distracted from our mission. We must not be distracted from the brokenness of people around us and their need for salvation. We must not get off track on doing what we're supposed to do as people of the cross. Not just as Americans, not just as Baptists, but as people of the cross. What are we supposed to be doing? Look to the cross. We look there for our commission. We look to the cross. Looking to the cross constantly reminds us of our purpose. I'm so glad when Brother Kyle made that cross for us. And we put it prominently in the center of the room. Now remember, shortly after it was up, and before we had remodeled anything, we still had the dark green curtain, and we took that down, and that cross hadn't been there very long, and we had been contacted by Congressman Buddy Carter's office. This was when they were doing those town halls. And they said, hey, we are looking for a place in that district to have a town hall. Would you mind us coming? I'm brand new. I've only been the pastor for a couple months. I'd never met Buddy Carter. I didn't know about all the town hall issues and all that. And we said, yeah, you can come. You can use, we want to, they vote here. We let the community vote here. You can come. It's open to you if you want to use it. And so they came, several hundred people came. I probably wouldn't do it again because of the way the people treated the congressman and the way that they were, disrespectful to a church building. And I had one person comment after and wrote me a little email and said, maybe we shouldn't have done that. I said, you know what? The truth is, however, that about 300 people, some of them had never been in a church in their life. Some of them had never been in a Baptist church in their life. And for an hour and a half, they sat there and looked at the cross. Shazam. God's going to get His glory one way or the other. Amen. And it may have been just a subtle thing in the background, but for an hour and a half, they looked at the cross. But you know, it's not just there as a decoration. There's 100 other things we could put in there. 100 other things we could put in there. Pictures, lights. We could put all kinds of things. Michael wanted a basketball hoop, so when he does his floaty with his little ducks, he could shoot hoops, you know. I'm just kidding. He doesn't do that, that I know of. No, we picked the cross on purpose because it's a focal point. Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night, funerals, concerts, weddings, community gatherings. We want to be constantly reminded. That's why we're here. That's why we're here as people of the cross. And we look to the cross for our commission and what we're supposed to be doing. And then we look to the cross for our comfort. We look to the cross for our comfort. Looking at the cross constantly reminds me of our Savior's love. The song says, oh, how he loves you and me. Oh, how he loves you and me. He gave his life. What more could he give? The song goes on, Jesus, keep me near the cross. There a precious fountain. The old rugged cross on a hill far away stood an old rugged cross. Oh, the cross is a song, a newer song. Listen to these words. My longing for love wouldn't go away. I was desperate, searching, broken by pain, looking for answers, but nothing seemed right. Where was my answer? What was my life? Blinded by sin, I was lost and deceived until I turned my eyes to Calvary. Oh, the cross where Jesus died. He shed his blood, gave his life for you and I. My sins erased, no longer lost. My debt was paid. I am saved. Oh, the cross. You know, there's so much brokenness in this world. And you don't have to go to Uganda. And you don't have to go to the dumps of Mexico. And you don't have to go out to the West Coast. And you don't have to go into the big cities like Atlanta. There's brokenness and sorrow right here in Savannah, Georgia. One of the reasons that I wanted to remain in chaplain ministry when I got here is because it keeps me associated with the brokenness of people. If you just surround yourself with preachers and Christians all the time, you can get numb or immune to the needs of people. And so it gives me an outreach as a pastor to be involved in lives of people outside of this building. And I'm just telling you, there's a lot of brokenness. Sorrow. People with no clue. No hope. No anchor. Without the Lord. And if we're going to be people of the cross, let's make sure that's not just a title. That it's not just a slogan. But that when we use that phrase, it reminds us who we are. Lifting up the cross, living by the way of the cross, and looking to the cross for our comfort and our commission. When ISIS sent that video, they knew who they were talking to. The media didn't pick up on it. But that's a war that's been raging for hundreds and hundreds of years between the crescent and the cross. The media didn't pick up on it. Lester Holt didn't have a clue. The government didn't pick up on it. By and large, there was no retaliation during that time period for that terrorist attack on Christians. But they knew who they were talking to. They knew how they see us, who named the name of Christ. The question is, do you know who they're talking to? Do you recognize yourself as a person of the cross? Are we living up to the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior? Would you bow in prayer with me, please? In the immediate, I would like to ask you this. If you're not saved, do you know that today could be the day of salvation? The power of the cross and the preaching of the cross, today can be the day of salvation because of what Jesus did on that cross for you and for me. Oh, the cross, you can be saved today. And then the second question would be to every Christian who's here in this building. Are you living the cross? Denying of self, submission to the Father, and showing compassion. Showing compassion to those who are lost. Sharing the gospel. Telling the story. Lifting up the name of Jesus. Or are you covering the cross with your attitude or your conduct or your habits? Are you hiding the cross in your life? Is your light shining brightly? Maybe you need to take the drape off today. Maybe you need to take the cover off the cross. And going to this next week and then to this world, knowing that you're a person of the cross and that the world around you needs to know the power of the cross in your life, how it changed your life and how it can change theirs. Father, bless this invitation. I pray that you would use the words of these scriptures, these illustrations, these examples today, to convict the hearts of your people. And Lord, especially the Holy Spirit would reveal to us if we have not been bold, if we've been ashamed of the cross, if we've been covering it up with our testimony not being what it might need to be. Speak to your people, Lord, today. May we deny ourselves and submit to your hand. Our heads still bowed and eyes closed before we stand and sing and complete the service. If you're watching us online today and you do not know Christ as your Savior, I've shared enough with you about the cross and about the blood and about the sacrifice of the Savior Jesus Christ. Enough knowledge for you to call upon him today. The Bible says that whosoever will call upon the name of the Lord will be saved or shall be saved. And friend, it's just simple faith. It's believing what Jesus did for you, and it's believing that if you call on him, he will save you. I shared a verse last week that said God cannot lie, and he promised eternal life to whoever would call in sincerity and belief and faith. And so today I would encourage you to pray with me the simple prayer. Dear Jesus, I believe you died on the cross for my sin and that I need to be saved. I also believe that you rose from the grave for my justification. And today I acknowledge my need of a Savior. And today I call upon you to save me, to forgive me of my sin. And today I ask you to be my Lord and my Savior. And I call on you sincerely in faith. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Would you stand and join me as we sing just a couple verses? Our time is waning. Just a couple verses. The altar's open. Hey, let's be people of the cross. The world needs to see us being what we're supposed to be. Oh, soul, are you weary and troubled? No light in the darkness you see. There's light for a look at the Savior, and life more abundant and free. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things on earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. One more verse, you're welcome to come. If there's anything we can share with you today, any prayer requests, we'd be glad to pray with you, to show you how to be saved, whatever you might need.
over us sin no more hath dominion, for more than conquerors we are. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace.
And all God's people said amen. Amen. Just very quickly before we leave, tonight I'm starting a series called Storm Clouds Rising. Storm Clouds Rising. It's a four-part series. It's about the rise of apostasy, the rise of persecution, the rise of evil, and ultimately the rise of the Antichrist. I know we talked about him a little bit back in January, but we have even more breaking things and news to share by the end of that series. So tonight's message, The Rise of Apostasy, a brand new series, Storm Clouds Rising, 5 o'clock. Hope that you can join us. Other good news is that when we do add Sunday school, these messages in the early service are going to have to get shorter. And you can thank me later for that, all right? No promises. I mean, short is a relative term, right? But they're going to get a little bit shorter out of necessity. We did print bulletins this week. Miss Wendy did that. She's been chomping at the bit to do that. But they're at the Welcome Center. You can get a copy. It's a smaller version of what we used to do until we can get back to some of our activities. We are lining up some things for September, October, November. But again, that's just all fluid. But we have to plan. Amen? We have to be ready. And the church, the work of the church has to go forward. We cannot coast, and we cannot sit in neutral. The world is dying all around us. People need the Lord, and missionaries need to go, and we need to keep doing what the church is supposed to be doing as people of the cross. So let's pray for the offering. The ushers are in the back today to receive your tithes and offerings. And if you don't already use the online option, we appreciate you giving and your stewardship and faithfulness. We took a big dip in June, but July was better, and so we're praying that August will keep plugging right along. So thank you for being good stewards of all that the Lord's entrusted to you. Father, thank you for our time.